my skeletal plan is to talk about my experience as a student, to go from just a little workshop to a diploma to a PhD. Taken me about 40 years, but I got there in the end. And now I do the same to unsuspecting students of mine. And I've also got a terrible cold for some reason. So I began like this, just with some taking some classes when I was in New York doing an MBA with these people, Lizette Modell and Halsman. Very inspiring. It was Modell who said I should take up photography, and I did, but I thought I should have a proper education. And that's what I did, diploma and then an MBA. So I went to England, did a diploma, which the three-year program became a degree. Later on, I did an MA and then a PhD now. So as far as teaching goes, these are my current part-time academic posts. I've never done teaching full-time. It's a thankless job in the UK. You just babysit for 5 days a week and never make any work. The first job here is the best. This is a new thing. I just got it. It's called professorial fellow. The school doesn't know what it means, and I don't know what it means. We're just inventing it. What it seems to mean is that I have hardly any students. Very good. And I have to write a very lengthy grant application. So the school is going to get £300,000. And if they get that, they're going to hire me for another couple of years. The other two jobs, one is a lecturing job. I lecture one day a week on photographic theory to MA students. And the RCA job is just as a visiting tutor. They call me in on demand. It's one of those jobs where you get no benefits. But they're all MA students, and the first job has suddenly given me, what they did give me were PhD students. I hadn't quite bargained for that. So I'm suddenly sort of been on a crash course how to teach people how to write their PhD thesis. Okay, so for those of you who may not know, this is Lizette Modell, and that's her work. She was absolutely adorable. I'll never forget her. And Philippe Halsman too, both French. Both had French accents in the 70s and lived in New York. Halsman is very famous for all these life covers. Also quite inspiring. All these people came from Europe with very little. He came with one camera, no lights, no equipment, and he talked about just starting a career. And this third one with the guy called George Tice, who's a lot less famous, but very crafty. It was all about printing. We came every week with 10 versions of the same negative. And it was very intense, and it introduced me, and it made me enjoy printing more than taking. So I became more print-oriented rather than camera-oriented. And then I spent my days just taking pictures like this. So basically, I got kind of inadvertently introduced to kind of New York modernism before I knew what it was. It was, you know, full frame, silver bromide, and so on. This was my diploma course. We had the luxury of space, which this school doesn't have anymore. So here we are with all this space, looking at our trannies. I think what you do get out of college, people all ask me, is it worth going? Is that you do have the space and the time to think about things and write about them. This was my amateur undergraduate takedown of Duane Michaels. Who the teacher had never heard of, because being gay, I wanted to find gay references. But back in the day, this is 1979, was legal in England, but no one really wanted to discuss it in the school. But I was very persistent. Every term I'd come back with a new gay project. This was another one. So I sort of became unteachable rather quickly. So I used documentary photography, which is what I thought I wanted to do, to investigate issues that were dear to my heart. And I made these tape slides. This was a tape slide. And so I combined my criticality about it. It was part documentary, the story, part a kind of critical photographic theory, which I put into it as well, and some photographic references. This went very badly with the subject matter, which was the organization London Gay Switchboard, and they said, there's no way you're going to show this to anyone else. Anyway, but this was kind of the politics of my time. I was heading very rapidly at the end of the 70s into this very separatist position. And then I had these lists of people who were influences. So as you can see, it goes from modernist photography through Sekula and Sontag to John Tagg. And then I was beginning to come back to India, in the sense that I'd left India at 15, never really taken pictures here then, to again now try to look at complex issues. I was very interested or kind of taken by this difference of the kind of rich and the poor and the way it's kind of connected. I was getting off the plane from the West in Delhi, which is where I came back. This is my hometown, actually. You're just struck, immediately you're struck by just the sheer economic difference of East and West, and then here, and also just here between the rich and the poor. Anyway, I studied this village in Rajasthan and began to produce the sort of documentary reports, I guess, with text and pictures. Became an exhibition. I was trying to find a way. This was what I was finding very difficult. How do you photograph a landless peasant? So this was very, how to visualize it. This was my kind of photographic problem. How to photograph the relationship between landlord and laborer. And then between privilege and power and the lack of it.
That's your picture?
Of Mrs. Gandhi? Yes, I have pictures of Mrs. Gandhi. I'll sell you one. So this particular image of a Bhil tribal woman who was actually a tribal leader. She was not a downtrodden person. Her face got picked up for this poster because it was very iconic and representative of non-European and indigenous people around the world. This was 1982. It's the first time I saw a photographic exhibition that was from India in London or anywhere in the West that I could think of. And in it, they had set up what we would think of as a selfie center. I noticed today's exhibitions all have a selfie point, but they had it. And instead of digital, we had Polaroids. So you could sit there with a Maharaja hat and have your picture taken. So I was passing through Delhi, trying to do this rural stuff. And I thought, oh, I'll have a look at what gay men are doing in Delhi. And what I found was that they didn't really want to be seen or photographed. It was all very invisibilized. So I took a picture, and then the Guardian said, is there a story? I said, yeah, there's a story. I'll go home and write one right now. That was it. So they became my twin interests, you know, India and homosexuality. So that was a documentary picture, and it kind of became the cover of this book. Meanwhile, back in London, we were having racially specific exhibitions. That's Sunil Jana, I just realized.
It's Jana.
A funny thing. I think of it. I guess he was in Wimbledon then. Must have been.
Pictures of him in your little bag.
That's true. Okay. So then, and this was a lesbian and gay show. This is 86. So the mid 80s was very radical, separatist, black and kind of gay, basically. And the discussions that was around them. So there was a huge one broke out between lesbians and gay men about pornography. And anti and pro pornography. The men felt that we needed our gay porn, really. And so there was this big like print discussion about it. Then at some point, the handful of black gay men found each other and went off to start off their own group. And there's an early notice of that. As you can say, it says black people only, but the black people are African, Asian, Caribbean, Chinese, and everything else, not white, just because black. So for a while I was black, and a lot of Indians didn't think I was black, but I thought I was black. So that was a weird moment in the mid-80s. And then I took some pictures like this for work for this kind of magazine. In the mid-80s, we created a kind of, began to have black exhibitions. This was an early one. And then I got very involved with the town hall and became which was a kind of very lefty place, and became familiarized with the notion of research for civics and writing reports and having to justify one's position. So the report on the left, the yellow one, which was about African, Caribbean, South Asian photography, led to the formation of something called Autograph, which is a funded organization. Similarly, this charter for LGBT rights led to a lesbian and gay center in London. So I became much more aware of research is important. So the next time we did a show, like this is a show out of India for London, we thought, okay, we got to have a book, some publication. Wasn't enough just to put the pictures up.
Great cover.
Great cover by Ram Rehman, no less. And Sanjeev was in it. That's how we met. And various other people. Shiba was in it. Ketaki Sheth was in it. And so I did shows that were about things that mattered. So there was the AIDS, HIV one. This was a very British take. We had enough of the Americans telling us all about it, so kept the Americans out of this one, just in the UK. And then this was Autograph's first exhibition of, and you might recognize somebody there. What's his name? Lyle Harris. We had Lyle Harris in this one, who's now having shows all over New York. And in Autograph, we were very ambitious. We wanted to have exhibitions, newsletter, education, and everything. Because we were the first generation of Black and Asian practitioners who had degrees, our fancy MAs, who could talk about it. So we had the language of something. So then, even though we were talking to our communities, we thought we needed this kind of newsletter. Oh, there you are again. Well, Ram Rehman and I obviously kind of had these periodic encounters in life. So there we are. That's Jana. That's your picture of us with Sunil Jana in Wimbledon. I firmly believe in going out, which is why when Vasan said, come to Delhi, and I said, you must be joking, it's January. I thought, I'll come anyway and see, you know, who you get to meet. But what I've met, first of all, is this blooming virus. But I met Laura Fan in Malaysia, who was an amazing American Chinese historian. We made a project out there. And this artist, Wong Hoi Chong, I did a solo show for him in England. I became a kind of curator in the 90s rather than a photographer. I got fed up of being camera for hire. It gets very repetitive, I have to say. I mean, this is commercial kind of editorial work, which was paying the rent. We talked earlier about this. You need something to pay the rent. Because I taught briefly and I saw how horrible it was going to be. So I quit after a year. I asked my school, can I go somewhere, you know, like in February? And they said, no, who's going to teach your class? So that was that. My God, there you are again. There's Ram again. It's a love letter to Ram Rehman. So in 88, I had my first encounter with the U.S. and professionally with photography at SPE in Houston. That's your show in New York. And so, Ram, you had the loft, yeah? And then, so he would say, oh, come stay with me. And then Ram was having this show in a commercial gallery.
That's
and that's that guy, Sushil. So up until then, I never thought that what one does has any commercial value. I never thought of the marketplace selling prints. So Ram kind of introduced me to the market accidentally or something. But he was very persuasive. So, oh, wow, we've got to go very quickly. So I'm going to fast forward to the 2000s, came back to Delhi. I turned 50 and thought, if I'm going to work in India, I want to do it now rather than retire, you know, and just put my feet up in Goa. So I turned up when I was 50, you know, with my suitcase and set up shop. And I found that there was almost nothing about photography, hardly any photo exhibitions and no photo magazines or any, just like there was that popular photography, but there wasn't much else to, but there was any discussion happening. So I had my great colleague and friend here, Radhika Singh, and I started this, and then soon Gauri Gill joined us, and we produced three or four of these a year. And the picture was, Ram gave us this picture. That's this, you already showed it.
Yeah, I showed half of it.
You showed half of it, yeah.
Neil and Margaret
Rothwell. The name comes from camera work in London. The idea was to have something in print. Someone talked about print earlier. To me, photography is in print. All this on digital on the screen, it doesn't do it. I have to have it in print. I guess I'm very old, so I need print paper. So we should just hand it around the place. So I became very obsessed. You know, one of my obsessions in life was that, where the hell is Indian photography? We've got to have it, bring it out somehow. And so this sort of research has happened, where Three Dreams Cross was a big exhibition looking at the history of the region. And, you know, obviously, if the history of this region cannot be exclusive of the other countries, we have to have Pakistan, India, and Bangladesh. They form a cohesive region. So, which unfortunately became a big issue to tour it to India. You know, that funny little man at the NGMA, he told me one day, you know, Sunil, aise bolte hain ke bas sab ek dream honi chahiye. And we were saying, just have one dream.
He was quite a large guy.
And a large guy. I said, no, we have three dreams. Can't be one dream. You can, you know, you can piss off. So that was, no show came then. But in Delhi, then I did all, I tried to do whatever you could. We had workshops. This is for HIV people. I joined these JNU people who were about 20 years old from JNU, started a queer group called Nigar. I said, I'm older than your parents. And they said, doesn't matter, you can come. And so then we started to do things, have shows and all that. Oh, there it is again. And then I got involved with the school's children, you know, middle school children who were about 10 years old. That was great fun. And I took them around to see shows. They met Homai. And I thought, wasn't that great? Like, when they're adults, they're going to look back at this and remember that they met Homai. And of course, that's the first class at NID. I have a lot to say, but with no time, no, absolutely zero time. It was an amazing experience, actually, going back into NID. Back in the sense that I'd been there when I graduated from the RCA in 83 and met some people there and said, yes, we'd like you to come and work here, but you'll have to live in Ahmedabad in Gujarat. I said, no way, I can visit. I'm not going to suddenly move to Ahmedabad. Okay, this was my biggest challenge, which I tried. I taught in Hindi at this little art school in Rohini, in North Delhi, to people who look like, mostly young women. And they normally had very traditional painting sculpture, but their very liberal principal was a friend of Anita Dubey's, and they suddenly wanted someone to teach media and photography. So it kind of was starting to work, but I mean, I introduced them to queer stuff, for example. We did a project. They all went out and came back with pictures of homosexuals they spotted around North Delhi. So they were quite open to many things, but I just didn't have any literature for them. You know, I didn't have any of the things. We don't publish in the vernacular language. There's no Hindi books. That's something to think about. India has got no photo text in the language. Okay, so Click was preceded with, Click was on the way to Three Dreams. This is just India and contemporary with Vadera. We collected 550 pictures. So many pictures, trying to put them up somewhere. There they are, it's opening night. There's Ram Rahman yet again. So, along with quite a few other people. That was really good to see everyone together. What is Vicky? It's Roy.
Yeah, Vicky. Yeah. There.
And yeah, we discovered Saurabh Hura for this. He was about 10 years old then or something. Meanwhile, so then I did part-time teaching. I go around and do odd lectures like this or like that. So the RCA has these fine art talks. Okay, so what I realized from the 80s and 90s experience was that we didn't have any publications in the 80s. So it's all got lost. So I'm very hung up now that we need a print, aside from the printed photograph, we need a printed, documented publication. Otherwise, You have no teaching materials. So I'd like to produce books if possible. So on the left here is the big book from Houston last year. Okay, my time's up. I'll bring the book in towards you, have a look at it. And that's the latest publication. And that's what the university is good for. We have research centers.